Mgt602 production operations management. So this is lecture 5 in the course, and lecture 5 corresponds to the date of the 8th of February 2021. So this is the second part of a discussion of 5 generic competitive strategies that are employed by businesses. We discussed the first part, for the first competitive strategy, which was very generic, and it was being a low-cost provider. We're going to look at 4 more in this particular lecture. So in general, we saw that there were 5 main generic competitive strategies that companies might opt to pursue. The first of those, the one that we looked at in the prior lecture, was being a low-cost provider, which meant that the company strived to achieve lower overall costs than their rivals, than their competitors, on products that attract a broad spectrum of buyers. So they're looking for market share, and they're looking to have their profit based on large volume, low cost. Low cost to produce, low cost to the buyer. Other strategies that we'll look at now in this presentation are broad differentiation, focused low cost strategies, focused differentiation, and a best cost provider. Briefly described, and we'll see these in greater detail as we proceed throughout this presentation, would be that broad differentiation is differentiating the firm's product offering from rivals with attributes that appeal to a broad spectrum of buyers. So differentiation based on attributes of the product, something that makes that product different from or differentiated from those offered by the competitors. A focused low-cost strategy concentrates on a very narrow price-sensitive buyer segment, i.e. focused, and on cost to offer a lower price product. Focused differentiation is now not broad differentiation, but focused differentiation. So now you're talking again about a narrow buyer segment so that you meet the specific taste and requirements of a very small, relatively speaking, niche market share or market segment. And then the best cost provider is the one that looks for a sweet spot where they give their customers more value for money by creating upscale product attributes or offering upscale product attributes at lower cost than their competition. Graphically, we might represent it this way. You saw this graph and you saw the preceding slide in the prior presentation. So this is just a reminder of what you've seen previously, that we can look at the type of competitive advantage being pursued, and there are 2 main ones right there. Of course, in reality, it moves along a spectrum from lower cost to differentiation. And on target market, the other axis, what we see is that we have a broad cross-section of buyers, or that we can be narrow, that is, focused. So at the intersection of those, you see the best cost provider strategy. So which quadrant of this you're in determines which of those first 4 generic competitive strategies that a company might be pursuing. For those who hope to hit the sweet spot, they're sitting at the intersection of the 4. So if we look at broad differentiation strategies, the second of the 5 generic competitive strategies, then effective differentiation approaches 1, carefully study buyer needs, behaviors, values, and their willingness to pay for a unique product or service. So there are people who choose, let's say, Apple iPhones because of unique features to the Apple iPhone. I have a Google Pixel. I choose that because of unique properties due to the Google Pixel. So unique product or service elements. Effective differentiation approaches also incorporate features that both appeal to buyers and create a sustainably distinctive product offering, and use higher prices to recover differentiation costs, because there is a cost to differentiation. There are some advantages of differentiation, just as there are different disadvantages, but the advantages include command of a premium price for the firm's products, increased unit sales due to attractive differentiation, brand loyalty that bonds buyers to the differentiation features of the firm's product. Now, this is broad differentiation as opposed to a really focused market segment. So keep your mind on that, keep your eye on that, but we're talking about broad differentiation. What is the core concept behind differentiation? That it enhances profitability wherever a company's product can command a sufficiently higher price. Right? Notice what that said. Command a sufficiently higher price or produce sufficiently greater sales to more than cover the added costs that are associated with differentiation. The essence of a broad differentiation strategy is that you offer unique product attributes that a wide range of buyers find appealing and worth paying for. So you have to have some sort of uniqueness driver that's built into that product that you're offering. It's a factor that can have a strong differentiating effect, but it has to be something that that broad spectrum of buyers actually values. You can have something that makes you unique that nobody cares about. I mean, that's entirely possible. You're looking for something that buyers actually care about and are willing to pay for so that they can have that thing that differentiates your product from someone else's. So what about those uniqueness drivers? Well, they have a strong differentiating effect. That is, they are not just something that makes you different. They contribute to your identity almost. So they have a strong differentiating effect. They can be based on physical as well as functional attributes of a firm's products. So not just how it looks, but in fact, what it accomplishes. It can be the result of superior performance capabilities of the firm's human capital. In other words, people make a big difference. So lots of companies are populated by truly incredible human resources, but not all companies achieve truly incredible results. And so the question is, do you have the right people in place with the right capabilities, the right abilities to carry out whatever it is that the company intends to emphasize? And similarly, a uniqueness driver can have an effect on more than one of the firm's value chain activities. It can create a perception of value, that is brand loyalty, in buyers where there is little reason for brand loyalty to otherwise exist. And your strategy will always begin with priorities. So consider a personal computer assembler. How much would we segment the market according to a product group? So if I'm doing that, how many different market segments are there? I mean, there are certainly people who go for very low-cost computers with very basic capabilities. They don't have to be fast. They don't have to have great graphics capabilities. Their software that they can communicate with doesn't happen to be that broad. They just have very basic needs. They want to do email. Maybe they want to write letters. So there are those customers for computers. Let's say laptops. There are others who use their laptops for high-end gaming. That requires a very different type of computer. So how would we segment the market of computer users according to the product groupings? How would we identify product requirements and demand patterns and profit margins for each group? Because that means that we have to be able to know what the market segment looks like. We need to know its size. We need to know how often they replace with something new. So many things that you need to know. We need to know how it is that we need to differentiate our products so that we can identify the increased cost of differentiation so that we can price our products that appropriately and so on. How do we identify order winners and order qualifiers for each group? How do we convert order winners into specific performance requirements? Those are all important things. You'd have to answer those sorts of questions if you're talking about a personal computer assembler and they want to pursue a broad differentiation strategy. So the point here is that you need to ask and answer relevant questions no matter which of those competitive strategies you choose to pursue. Ask and answer relevant questions. So order qualifiers and winners. Well, there's us and there's them, and we're trying to differentiate ourselves from them. Order qualifiers, what are those? That's by qualifiers, we don't mind, we don't mean customers. We mean criteria. Okay, so order qualifiers are screening criteria that permits a firm's products or services to be considered as possible candidates for purchase. In other words, there are certain products that I would not even consider buying unless they were able to accomplish certain things. Order winners. What are order winners? Those are the criteria that make your product the product of choice. That's what we're looking for. So they, how do they do that? By differentiating your product or your services from someone else, from some other company. So what are some of those value drivers? Well, some of those value drivers, the keys to creating differentiation, are things like quality control processes, the product features and performance, I think would be an obvious one to you. Depending on what it is that you're doing, customer service, production research and development, that can be very important. Technology and innovation can certainly be an important factor. The quality of the input, and what I mean by that is the quality of the materials that are used in the actual composition or construction of the device that you're trying to sell, the product you're trying to sell. Employee skill, training and experience, that's important. World-class companies, with respect to how they train their human resource, invest enough in their human resource, their human capital, that they provide about 40 hours annually of training to their employees just to improve their skills, just to make sure that they fit better with the organization, organizational priorities for the purpose of fulfilling customer needs. And then sales and marketing can obviously have a big effect too. So how do you manage the value chain to create differentiating attributes? Well, one, you create product features and performance attributes that appeal to a broad range of buyers. Remember, these are broad differentiating strategies that we're looking at right now. Broad differentiation, wide differentiation. They improve customer service or they add extra services. They invest in production, related research and development activities. They strive for innovation and technological advance. They pursue continuous quality improvement. Now, that should be happening in every organization. They increase marketing and brand building activities. They seek out high quality inputs so that the outgoing product, the one that actually reaches your customer, is of higher quality. And they emphasize human resource management or human resource ecology activities that improve the skills, the expertise, the knowledge of the people in your company. And depending on the type of company you operate, if you're a really large one, maybe also improve the skills, knowledge, and expertise of those and some of your suppliers. Okay, that's something that GE does, for example. So that's what those elements on the prior slide, how you should be interpreting those elements on the prior slide. When you revamp the value chain or invigorate the value chain, to increase differentiation, then you're looking for approaches that enhance differentiation through changes in the value system. Obviously, you can coordinate with those in the channel to enhance customer perceptions of value. And you can coordinate with suppliers to better address customer needs. So let's see, coordinating with channel allies to enhance customer perceptions of value. You might require the recall the failure of airbags in a number of cars several years ago. A lot of those airbags were made by Takata. Okay. So what would you do instead? If you're having trouble with Takata airbags, then instead you might work with another airbag manufacturer. And we will talk about one of those when we talk about lean enterprise methods. And we will show you how they approach things differently. How do you deliver superior value via a broad differentiation strategy? Well, you offer customers things that your competitors can't. Or maybe you're offering something that your competitors can, but not as well, not as good. So you incorporate product attributes and user features that lower the buyer's overall cost of using the firm's product. You might also do things that increase the ease of use of your product. So shallow learning curves. So you might do things that are highly intuitive. Okay, that could be part of your differentiation strategies. We want our products to be highly intuitive. So one of the things that made a difference years and years ago between Hewlett-Packard handheld calculators and Texas Instruments handheld calculators. Hewlett-Packard used something called reverse Polish notation. Effectively, you had to be a programmer to be able to use Hewlett-Packard handheld calculators, where you had to get a lot of training, get a lot of experience, read your user manual like crazy, figure out how to do that, whereas Texas Instruments was just highly intuitive. So that was one of the things that fueled some of the early popularity of Texas Instruments handheld calculators. You didn't have to have that deep, steep learning curve that were associated with Hewlett-Packard calculators. So, you know, there are a number of things that are here. So when it says incorporate product attributes and user features that lower the buyer's overall cost, don't think of cost only as money, even though that's a common conception. For me, the cost that I have is not just money, it's my time, because I value my time. I value the attention I have to give something, or that I don't have to give something. So those are also ways of differentiating your product. You incorporate tangible features, i.e. styling, that increase customer satisfaction with the product. Or maybe it's not just customer satisfaction. If you're looking at a narrow differentiation strategy, not a broad one, it might be something that's more prestige-oriented, for example. And I'll try and remember and talk about a prestige-oriented one when we talk a little bit about narrow differentiation. We incorporate intangible features, that is the buyer image. Mercedes tends to have better perception than Kia or than Ford or than lots of other alternatives. So incorporate intangible features, i.e. buyer image, that enhance buyer satisfaction in non-economic ways. Not everything is about money. It's about image sometimes. And it signals the value of the firm's product offering to buyers. So it could be in the way that you package. It could be any number of things. Notice the distinctive packaging that Apple uses, for example. Signaling value is very important. When? The nature of differentiation is based on intangible features. Things that you can't put your hands on, that instead you have to wrap your mind around, that you perceive as opposed to actually experience. So it's based on intangible features. Excuse me, and is therefore subjective or hard to quantify by the buyer. It's important when buyers are making a first-time purchase and are unsure what their experience will be with the product. It's important when the product or service repurchase by buyers is infrequent. So, for example, if you're talking about a car, most people don't trade cars every year. Most people don't get a new laptop every year. Things like washing machines, stoves, refrigerators, those are called durable goods. They're called durable goods because they're intended to last a long time. So things where repurchase is infrequent, carpet, then signaling value, quality, value, that's all important during those circumstances. And buyers are relatively unsophisticated. That's also important. So if they're unsophisticated, what that means is that they can't necessarily tell the difference between your product and someone else's. Therefore, you have to effectively communicate to them why yours is better, why and how. What are some of the strategic management principles that are involved? The differentiation can be based on tangible things you can wrap your hands around, put your hands on, touch, feel, see, tangible attributes, or intangible ones like image, reputation, and so on. Easy to copy differentiating features can't produce a sustainable competitive advantage because they're so easily copied. Any differentiating feature that works well is a magnet for imitators. Well, of course it is, because if it does well for you, there's always somebody who is waiting to say, I can do that too, and I can profit from that. and over-differentiating and overcharging are fatal strategy mistakes. That is, sometimes it's good not to be too unique, and it's good not to charge too much, because then you automatically narrow the field of buyers that you have, the market that you can appeal to. What are some successful approaches to sustainable differentiation, ongoing differentiation? Well, it's differentiation that's difficult for rivals to duplicate or imitate, or it's very expensive for them to do so. That's what you're looking for. So what are those sorts of things? Things like company reputation, which usually take a long time to build. That's why Mercedes has such a great company reputation, or BMW or some others. So company reputation usually take time to build. Long-standing relationship with buyers that enable you to have collaborative relationships that produce greater innovation, or that enable their components to work better in your products and so on, or that create maybe a cost advantage for you because you're a preferred customer and they're a preferred supplier. So, or a unique product or service image. Those things are the things that are difficult for rivals to duplicate or imitate. But you're also looking for differentiation that creates a substantial switching cost that automatically or almost automatically locks buyers into staying with you. So that's things like patent-protected product innovation, because patents extend for a number of years, and they can be renewed. And so you can protect that intellectual property. Now, the truth of it is, here's what a patent really does. A patent gives you the ability to sue, to litigate. That's what really happens with patents. And a really informative movie, you could probably find it free at YouTube for you to watch if you're interested in something like that, would be a movie called A Flash of Genius. And it's about the individual who created the variable speed windshield wipers for cars. And it was rolled out by Ford, but it wasn't created by Ford. And this man wanted, it wasn't even just the money he wanted, it was that he wanted the recognition that he created the variable speed windshield wiper, and he was not a Ford employee. Okay, but what happened in his case is that that was so important to him, and Ford was the 800,000 pound gorilla, and he was just one individual. So that he ended up losing his family, going through divorce, being put in a mental institution. Eventually he came out of that and was awarded some amount of money that was nothing approaching what his creation was actually worth. So, very insightful movie, but it'll give you a little bit of an idea about what patent protection is and isn't. A Flash of Genius. So worth the watch if you can find it. And then differentiation that creates substantial switching costs to lock-in buyers, relationship-based customer service. So you have such a strong relationship with the customer that they would have to establish that brand new with someone else. You know them. They're almost more like your friend or your family than they are just a customer, so to speak. So when do differentiation strategies work best? When there are market circumstances that favor differentiation naturally. And among those circumstances are the four that you see at the bottom of this particular slide. So the buyer needs and uses for the product are diverse. There are many ways that differentiation can have value to buyers. Few rival firms are following a similar approach. There's rapid change in product technologies and features. There are some things that you really want to avoid if you're pursuing a differentiation strategy. Relying on product attributes that are easily copied, because that particular advantage goes away quickly, or can go away quickly, if that attribute is attractive enough that it's creating market share for you and it's easily imitated, then somebody else can do that as well. You also want to avoid introducing product attributes that really don't mean much to buyers, right? They're not enthusiastic about it. when you, you want to avoid eroding profitability by overspending on efforts to differentiate the firm's product offering. So you're spending so that you're different, but you're not getting the return on the amount that you're spending. That's eroding profitability. Offering only trivial improvements in quality service or performance features vis-a-vis the products of rivals. So it's not that you're not improving, it's that your improvement is nothing special compared to your competitors. Over-differentiating the product quality, features, service levels, etc., that exceeds the needs of most buyers. So customers have needs, recognized needs, but they're not necessarily willing to pay for things that go above and beyond if they see no value in that. And obviously, charging too high a price premium is a failure that you want to avoid. Now, what if we're talking about focus strategies? Then we have two focus strategies we can look at that we haven't so far. You can either have a focused low-cost strategy, or you can have that focused market niche strategy, differentiation. So when you have a focused low-cost or focused differentiation strategy, when are those attractive? Well, they're attractive when the target market niche is big enough to be profitable and offers good opportunity for growth. It's attractive when industry leaders chose not to compete in the niche. Okay? Focusers avoid competing against strong competitors. That's just what happens. The companies who choose to focus don't compete against strong competitors. It's costly or difficult for multi-segment competitors to meet the specialized needs of niche buyers. It requires too much specialization on their part. Okay. And the industry has many different niches or segments that you can choose from in which you want to compete. And rivals have little or maybe no interest in the target segment that you're pursuing. Those are the sorts of places or circumstances under which focused differentiation or focused low-cost strategy are attractive. Now, there are risks to focused low-cost or focused differentiation strategies, and we would be incomplete if we didn't identify what some of those things are. So, one risk, competitors find a way to match the focus firm's capabilities in serving the target niche. You had no competition, now you do. Right? You were doing something unique. Now it's not so unique because they're able to identify how to do that. Or the specialized preferences and needs of the niche members shift over time toward the product attributes desired by a majority of buyers. In other words, they're almost no longer a niche. They become just part of, been absorbed by that larger group of ordinary, let's say, buyers. And three, it's also a risk that the attractiveness of the market segment increases. So it draws more competition, and that intenses rivalries and splintering of segment profits. So it may have been terrific at the start because you were focused, but the value of that focus erodes over time because it was profitable enough for you that it drew other competitors. What about best cost provider strategies? Remember, that's the sweet spot. We had the four quadrants, two axes, and right at the middle of that graphic, the second slide in this presentation, second slide in this lecture, you saw a graphic, and at the center of that were the best cost providers who try and provide the best of both worlds in terms of differentiation and cost. So from a differentiation perspective, you're trying to provide desired quality features, performance, and service attributes. If you're talking about the low-cost provider, you're trying to charge at a lower price than rivals with similar quality and caliber product offerings. So the best-cost provider tries to accomplish both of those things at the same time, and who they are appealing to or trying to appeal to would be what we call value-conscious buyers. Best-cost provider strategies, they are a hybrid then of being a low-cost provider strategy and differentiation strategies, and they aim to provide more desirable attributes at reasonable prices. When does it work best, this best cost sort of strategy approach? It works best when product differentiation is expected. It's the norm out in the marketplace. When there are a large number of value-conscious buyers who prefer mid-range products. Right? So almost automatically, this best cost provider approach implies that you're looking for mid-range products in terms of value and cost. So you're not talking about buyers who just want the cheapest deal because maybe that's what they can afford, or maybe they have other reasons for doing that. And you're not looking for those who just have to have the prestige of a high-end product. You're looking for that mid-range. It works well, and it's value for money. But you need to have a big enough market segment there. Large number of value-conscious buyers who prefer mid-range products. It works well when there's competitive space near the middle of the market for a competitor with either a medium-quality product at a below-average price, so medium-level product but it doesn't cost as much, or a high-end product at an average or slightly higher price. So, in other words, we can get something with the quality of, the quality of a BMW for the cost of a mid-range Ford. That would be terrific, wouldn't it? And economic conditions have caused more buyers to become value conscious. And I think we're, relatively speaking, in that position right now in light of the COVID-19 pandemic that's been raging for about the last year. So the risk of a best cost provider strategy, that's getting squeezed in. That you have high-end differentiators who take away some of your business, that you have low-cost providers who take away some of your business, you really do have to hit a sweet spot. And then there are some contrasting features now of the five generic competitive strategies we've talked about. So now we're getting toward the end of our discussion about competitive strategies. So each one of those five generic competitive strategies positions a firm differently in its marketplace. It establishes a central theme for how the firm intends to compete with rivals. It creates boundaries or guidelines for strategic change as market circumstances unfold and become more obvious and so on. And it entails different ways and means of maintaining the basic strategy. If we want to summarize those, we could summarize those things in this graphic. And we won't go over every box in this table. But here's the idea. That we had the five strategies, those form the columns in this table. Low-cost provider, broad differentiation, focused low-cost provider, focused differentiation, and then the sweet spot, the best-cost provider. So what you'll be able to see is that if you look at those five strategies relative to each of the rows, strategic target, basis of competitive strategy, the product line, and the product emphasis, you'll be able to see how those five strategies differ from one another relative to, say, strategic target, or relative to the basis of competitive strategy, or relative to the product line, or relative to the production emphasis. So if we just look at one of those, let's say the strategic target, low-cost providers look at a broad cross-section of the market. Broad differentiation looks at a broad cross-section of the market. Well, that's the same. You're looking for different types of buyers, but nevertheless, they focus on broad cross-sections of the market. Whereas focused differentiation, well, focused low cost is narrow market niche, where buyer needs and preferences are distinctly different. The same thing is true in focused differentiation, but they're approaching that narrow market differently. And the best cost provider, you're looking for value-conscious buyers on middle market range. And you can look at the ways that these five strategies differ on those other three components as well, the other three rows of the table. So what are some of the distinguishing features? We have another table. So you see this five strategies, again, forming the columns in this table. And now we're looking at marketing emphasis, the keys to maintaining your strategy, and the resources and capabilities required. If you look at the prior slide, this is a continuation of the table on the prior slide. So you could look at these things as well. Ultimately, successful competitive strategies are resource-based. human resource-based, material resource-based, etc. So a firm's competitive strategy is most likely to succeed if it is formulated on leveraging a competitively valuable collection of resources and capabilities to match the strategy. So if you want to sustain your competitive advantage, then that depends on your resources, your capabilities, and your competences that are difficult for rivals to duplicate and that don't have any good substitutes. No clear, easy substitutes available. Company's competitive strategy should be well matched to its internal situation and predicated or formulated based on leveraging its collection of competitively valuable resources and capabilities. That's the idea. So it isn't generally the case that we just say, here's our competitive strategy. It's more like the idea that we need to know who we are, who we want to be, and how we want to get there. And then you choose your competitive strategy appropriately. You need to determine whether or not you're a provider of mid-range level products or whether you're looking for low-cost or high-end. You need to know whether you're looking for a broad market so that you have a large market share or whether you're focused in what you do, specialized in what you do. And then lastly, we want to talk about just a little bit about the triple bottom line and the balanced scorecard. So the balanced scorecard examines company performance based on four perspectives. And these are the ones. So when we want to see how we're doing as a company, then we will say, from a financial perspective, from the perspective of our shareholders, how are we doing? What do we think? The internal perspective. What do we think? How do we think we're doing? The all-important customer perspective. How do those outside who are our customers, how do they think we're performing as a company? And then lastly, the innovation and learning perspective. Are we advancing in our innovation appropriately? Are we keeping up with or leading the market in terms of innovation? Are we a fast learning organization? Or are we stagnant? The balanced scorecard seeks to evaluate or assess company performance based on those four perspectives. So those are the balanced scorecard perspectives. Whereas the triple bottom line, and we've discussed it very, very briefly in one of the prior lectures. Triple bottom line, often we call it PPP, People, Planet, Profit. People, Planet, Profit. But it's the idea that companies used to focus purely on the financial bottom line, but that the world has evolved in ways where that's not enough for most companies. Most companies and most consumers are expecting more like triple bottom line performance, triple bottom line sensitivities. And the triple bottom line would essentially say, look, it is important to operate profitably. If you don't operate profitably, you're going to go out of business ultimately. So you have to operate profitably. That's the financial dimension, or the so-called profit dimension. But it's also important that you are socially responsible and that you are attuned to social justice, that you're attuned to inclusion and diversity and all of the things that are important from a human resource management perspective, but also just being good citizens of the world and in the communities in which your organization operates. And that would be the people. But it's also important that we are environmentally responsible. So the triple bottom line looks at those three areas of performance for the organization: people, planet, profit. Now there's a reality. The reality says if I wanted to, and I should want to, as I assess my company performance, it is important to know how your company performs year on year. I could easily set up a 3x4 table. I could set up a table that said, what's the financial perspective? What's the internal perspective? What's the customer perspective? What's the innovation and learning perspective? So the balanced scorecard perspectives could easily enough be the columns in that table. And the people, planet, profit, triple bottom line dimensions could be the rows in that table. And you could be more fine, more detailed in terms of the way that you assess your company by looking at that cross consideration of triple bottom line with balanced scorecard. So that's what we have. And that would be the end of the segment. If you're sitting in the class watching this, there's always the possibility somebody's watching this that is not enrolled in Mgt602. But if you're watching this, then this concludes that first large PowerPoint file, which is lectures 1 through 5, that represents an overview of production and supply chain management, or operations and supply chain management. And the next topic that we'll move into after this will be sustainable supply chains. Thanks very much.